Welcome back everyone. In this video I'll be covering the basics of valve adjustment for first generation KLX 250S, years 2006 and 7. It will also apply for the second generation, which starts from 09 up to 2014, and possibly up to this day, because Kawasaki's don't make major changes to already well-designed engines. As a standard procedure, we need to open access to valve cover, which involves getting everything around it out of our way. Do yourself a favor and take a picture of the cable and wiring layout. This will prevent accidental throttle lock due to incorrect cable positioning. Once you get a clear view of the valve cover, remove bolts holding it in place, but don't pull the cover just yet. Instead, squirt some kerosene around the edge of the valve cover, soaking the gasket. Then gently tap the cover, allowing kerosene to seep between the gasket and the cover. This trick will allow you to remove valve cover without damaging the gasket and saving you time and money in the end. I do this trick for all my gaskets now. If this trick saved you money, feel free to send me a hug and a kiss using PayPal link in the description. Once cover and gasket are removed, carefully go around the edges, removing any excess gasket maker material so it won't drop into the engine. Also, I later learned that removing this coil makes valve cover removal a lot easier, so do it first. On the left side of the engine, locate and open both crankshaft access and the inspection hole. Rotate the crankshaft counterclockwise until you see a vertical line and the letter T turn 90 degrees to the left inside the inspection hole. The vertical line is the top dead center mark. We confirm top dead center by looking at the cam lobes pointing opposite directions from each other. Note that precision is not critical here. As long as these lobes point in the opposite directions and the mark is somewhat close, you're good to go to take the measurements. Armed with the filler gauges and owner's manual for clearance values, I will try to slip it between the lobe and the bucket, but not forcing it. I will use smaller and smaller filler gauge until I find the one that fits with a small drag, and then write that gauge number into my form. I will repeat the same process for all four valves, remembering that according to manual, inlet, the intake or the carburetor side of the engine, and the exhaust side have different clearances. With all the numbers written down, I'll make a couple of marks on the timing chain, the camshaft sprocket with the Sharpie. This step is critical and it prevents you from setting incorrect timing as you put everything back together. Next step is to loosen the timing chain by removing chain tensioner. Once that's out of the way, I proceed with removing bracket that holds the camshafts. Bracket bolts need to be loosened on a specific order, which is shown in the owner's manual. Alternatively, you can remove each bolt by turning it out one full turn at a time, until they're all completely gone. Keeping in mind that camshafts are under tension, so removing those bolts in order or evenly is very important. Using magnetic pickup tool, I will lift the bucket, inside which I will find the shim, which I need to measure. Once measured, I will write the measurements in my form and continue with the rest of them. With all the numbers written down and entered into my form on a computer, I will take the minimum and the maximum clearance values from the manual and type them into the form for both exhaust and the inlet yellow boxes. These numbers are used to calculate perfect gap I will be aiming for. Before you go looking for needed shim, note that most Kawasaki's use 7.48mm diameter shim. So it really doesn't matter what bike you pick when you shop for shims. All you need to pay attention to is the diameter of the shim and its thickness that you measured earlier. Suggested shim size is not always available. What we have to do now is to find the closest size we can buy by looking up the list of available sizes. Entering the shim size you plan to install will tell you the gap you should get. Try that first, it'll prevent you from buying the wrong size shim. Don't forget to take leftover shims into account. You may end up simply swapping a couple without needing to buy anything. Week of delivery later, I will place new shims where they are needed and put everything back together, making sure I match the marks I made earlier. Continue with tightening the camshaft bracket in the reverse order following the pattern from the owner's manual, as well as properly torquing them in the end. The next step is to reset and reinstall chain tensioner. This is done by removing the large bolt with a spring and a stem inside of it. Then, pulling away latch mechanism, I will push the leg into the tensioner. I will now reinstall tensioner 8mm side bolts first, and then I will insert the large bolt with the spring and the stem. You should hear it click as it goes in, and it will click later as you crank the engine, setting proper tension on the chain in the process. I will now turn the crankshaft a couple of full turns so that the tensioner can apply tension on the chain. You should hear it click a few times as you're doing it. Then I'll set the cylinder to top dead center and recheck all valve clearances once again to make sure everything is as expected. If something's out of spec, I'll have to repeat the process once again. Just be sure to not reuse your old marks. Once the engine's rotated, they're useless. After cleaning the gasket and the cover, I will apply new gasket maker only in the sharp corners like so. Then let it sit under minimum tension as instructed. Tighten the specs and the rest is history. Thank you for watching. Have a blessed day and ride safe. Bye bye.